So you can see my screen now?
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, thank you. So welcome to my talk. I'm Maarten Broekman, a PhD student from the Radboud University in Nijmegen. And my presentation will be about the empirical validation of expert-based habitat suitability information with GPS tracking data of terrestrial mammals. And I got help from these people on this study. This picture shows an example of one of the most important biodiversity stressors at the moment, the conversion of one habitat type into another habitat type. And to assess whether this is a problem for a species, it's important to know the suitability of the different habitat types for a species. So that we can quantify future effects of habitat conversion on species. And to get this information on habitat suitability of different habitat types from species, we can derive information from different sources. First of all, we can use occurrence records of species, or you can use expert knowledge. So to start with the first type of data, occurrence records, you can think about data we get from radio tracking species or from fitting species with GPS collars. And with these data, we can derive the habitat types in which a species occurs. And then we can calculate metrics of habitat suitability. A disadvantage of this type of information that it requires many data for each species. So it's not available for many species or across a large scale. So this information is mostly used in local scale studies on a small number of species. But for many type of studies which are performed on many species on a global scale, you cannot use the occurrence record. So then mostly expert knowledge on habitat suitability is used. Often used source of information is the data from the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, the IUCN. For example, this is an example of the habitat suitability information for the wolf from the IUCN, on which you can see here a list of habitat types that are suitable for the species. And this data is available for almost all mammal species, so it's suitable information to use in macroecological studies on a global scale. But this information is only based on the knowledge of experts, no direct data input. So you can wonder like how well does this information from expert knowledge correspond with information we would derive from empirical data such as from GPS tracking data. So that is what I studied in this research. What is the degree of agreement between habitat suitability metrics derived from the International Union for the Conservation of Nature and GPS tracking data? And to answer this question, I used GPS tracking data for 49 different mammal species, of which I showed pictures here. So these are the scientific names of the species, and I've also added the common names of the species. For each species, I use data from multiple individuals. In total, I have data from 1,498 individuals. And these individuals come from 114 different populations, which I define here as a group of individuals that occur in roughly the same area. For example, for the red fox, I have data from individuals from Australia and from Germany, so that are two different populations. The total number of locations I have from all individuals is more than 10 million, which leads to 5,765 locations per individual. And and species also show a nice spread in body mass, in diet categories, and I have habitat specialists as well as habitat generalists in my data set. And they also the data also comes from different parts in the world, as you can see in this picture. And with the GPS tracking data, I want to calculate two different habitat suitability metrics. First of all, the proportional use, which is simply the proportion of occurrence records in each habitat type. For example, imagine this is a landscape with three different habitat types, the red, the green, and the yellow habitat type. And these are the occurrence records of a species. So for this imaginary species, most occurrence records occur in the green habitat type. So based on the proportional use, we would identify that the green habitat type is suitable. But I also look at another habitat suitability metric, the selection ratio, which is the proportional use of a habitat type relative to its availability. To illustrate it, we can look at the yellow habitat type here. This habitat type does not have the most occurrence records of the species, but the habitat type is also very rare in this landscape. So relative to the availability of a habitat type, the habitat type is actually used quite a lot. So based on the selection ratio, we would identify this yellow habitat type as suitable. So they are kind of complementary metrics of habitat suitability that identify suitable habitats in different ways. So how do I calculate this habitat suitability metrics? To illustrate it, I use again an example of an individual of the wolf, of which you can see the occurrence records from the GPS data here. And I overlay these records on a map with IUCN habitat types. And then I calculate the number of observations in each habitat type. And the proportional use of each habitat type is then simply the proportion of the number of observations in each habitat type from the total number of observations. So for example, this is an example of how I would calculate it for the habitat type boreal forest. And these are the resulting proportional use values for this individual. To calculate the selection ratio, I also have to calculate availability of each habitat type. Therefore, I draw a minimum convex polygon around all location points of an individual. And the availability of each habitat type is then the proportional area of each habitat type within this minimum convex polygon. And the selection ratio is then the proportional use divided by the available proportion of each habitat type. And this is again an example of how you would calculate it for the boreal forest. And these are the results for all habitat types for these individuals. And then in the last column, I have the habitat suitability information from the IUCN. So in my study, I'm going to compare these proportional use and selection ratio values with the suitability information from the IUCN. So this is just an example of one individual. As I said, I have data for each species from multiple individuals. So for the wolf, these are the selection ratios for all habitat types and all individuals. The orange curve shows the distribution of selection ratio values for all unsuitable habitat types. And the greenish curve shows the distribution of the selection ratio for all individuals and habitat types that are suitable. And with these data, I'm going to calculate one species-specific selection ratio for all suitable habitat types and all unsuitable habitats for this species. To do that, I fit a regression model in which the selection ratio is a function of the suitability based on the IUCN, so whether the IUCN classifies the habitat type as suitable or unsuitable. And the coefficients of this regression model represent a species-specific selection ratio for suitable and for unsuitable habitat types, which in this plot here are indicated with the green and orange vertical line. And then finally, I performed parametric bootstrapping with 5,000 simulations to calculate the probability that this species-specific selection ratio for suitable habitat types is larger than for unsuitable habitat types. And for this example, for the wolf, this probability is 100%. And for the proportional use values, I perform similar calculations. So, and this could plot, I plotted the results of all species that I have in my data set. On the left-hand side of the plot, you can see the name of the species. And then there are two numbers between parentheses. The first number is the number of populations for the species. So that's three populations for the African elephant, for example. And the second number is the total number of individuals for the species. So in the case of the African elephant, this is 15 individuals. Then these orange and green dots represent the species specific selection ratio values for unsuitable habitat types and for suitable habitat types for the species, with these error bars indicating the 95% confidence intervals. And on the right-hand side, I calculate are the probabilities that the suitable habitat types, the selection ratio for suitable habitat types are larger than for the unsuitable habitat types. So on average for all species, based on the selection ratio, the probability of agreement is 88%. Most species have a large probability of agreement, so the probability that the suitable habitat types have a higher selection ratio than unsuitable habitat types. For example, for the African elephant and the American black bear, this probability is 100%. But there are also some species that have a low probability of agreement, lower than 5%. For example, here at the almost at the bottom of this plot, the vervet monkey, the probability of agreement is 0%. You can also see that unsuitable habitat types actually have a higher selection ratio than the suitable habitat types for this species. For the proportional use estimates, the results are comparable. The average probability of agreement is a bit lower, but still 79%. 33 species have a probability of agreement that's higher than 95%, and 4 species have a probability that's lower than 5%. So what can we conclude from these results? So in general, there is a large agreement between the IUCN data and the GPS results. So for using this data in macroecological studies, that's probably going to work. But there are a few species that have a low probability of agreement. And also when I look at the level of the specific species, which I did not show, where there are some habitat types that are suitable, but actually have a lower selection ratio of proportional use than unsuitable habitat types. So my recommendation would be to use this GPS data to improve the IUCN habitat suitability data for species. And with that, I would like to end to my presentation and thank you for your attention.
Thanks, Martin. I think there's a comment in the question for speakers that you might want to check out. One question we have is, do you see any tendency of habitat generalists to have lower or higher agreements?
No, I actually looked at that, but there was no effect of habitat specialists or habitat generalists having a higher probability of agreement.
Okay, another question by Natalie. Do you think this would be a good way of identifying possible invasive species?
I haven't thought about it. I think at least, I'm not sure, but I think at least GPS tracking data is a really valuable source of information, because you have many data points for each individual. But I have to think about it more.
Yeah, no worries. If you have another answer, you can just put it in the questions for speakers. To keep on time, I think we'll move on. That's all right. Thanks, Mark.